So, I got 10 minutes to talk to you all today, and my talk is building secure applications. So, a bit about me, after that introduction, it's mostly all you need to know, but yeah, I'm a developer advocate with Auth Zero, acquired by Okta a couple years ago. I'm an outdoorsy guy, got a family of my own, and I've always been a dev for as long as I can remember. I think 2013 is when I started. Started with the mean stack and then Vern, and I do some Vue stuff for fun too. So kind of do a little bit of everything. But yeah, I only got 10 minutes, so I'll jump right into it. So I wanted to talk about security stuff and how we can, what little things we can do with our applications to secure them. So today I'm going to talk about two things, like some of the biggest threats that applications get hit with today. And the second thing is some solutions that you can add into your own apps as developers to secure them better. So these are kind of the three biggest things that are attacking apps today: brute force attacks, credential stuffing, and phishing. So brute force attacks is basically when a hacker or a bot or something comes to an application that doesn't have like a timeout or a limit of how many logins that you can try to do per tit. That's where they can just kind of hit a bunch of different emails, a bunch of different passwords, and continue till finally one cracks. Credential stuffing is where maybe your username and password, you've used it on a site that's been breached. Hackers get that information and then go to like Amazon or Facebook or something else and then try to use your password in your email for those other applications and see if they work. So how many people reuse their passwords? Yeah, everybody does. How many of us rely on autofill in our browsers to sign us in? Yep, me too. I do a little bit as well. And phishing is where you get an email from Amazon. It says to sign in, click on the button. It looks a little fishy, but it looks like Amazon's colors and stuff. And you sign in, you give it your username and password. It wasn't Amazon, and you just got hacked. They just took your username and password. And if you didn't notice it, if they signed you out or redirected to Amazon, you didn't really catch it, you just got phished. They took your email and password. Actually, it's funny. A lot of companies in corporate settings, IT departments are actually like, how do people have been like played by their own company? All right, that happens a lot. I don't know why, but they're like trying to test us and see if they can phish us. So now I just ignore most of that stuff that comes from it. But that's what phishing is. So if you get the theme here, each one of those things revolves around your password, right? Your text-based password. Password 1234 doesn't really work that well, but a lot of us feel like key muddy, and we don't have any more passwords in us. I've gone through all the different iterations of mine, and I've run out of passwords. So a lot of us rely on one password and LastPass, and even those are better than you memorizing your password or using autofill to sign you in. But even still, passwords aren't the best thing. So there are a couple options as developers that we can do for our applications so that we don't have to rely on users when they use our app to give us a text-based password. Some of those things are web authn, which I'm gonna talk about. And another thing is email and text one-time passwords, right? It's a little bit annoying to do it this way, and it might break the UX a little bit, but you can text the code that expires in 5 minutes or whatever that users can then use to sign in. But it's a lightning talk, and not much time, so I'm gonna talk about web authn. So web authn is slang for web authentication API. So how many people know websites where you try to like sign in, you give it your email or username, and then it pops up in your computer asking for your fingerprint to sign in? All right, a lot of people do that. That's web authn. So that biometrics for using it for your application is web authn. It's a biometric thing. There's other factors and flavors to it, but that is a passwordless authentication that you can add to your application. And how does it work? So instead of using a password, your browser or your platform, a phone, whatever it is, it creates something called a public-private key cryptography, and it uses that instead of a password. So a private key is stored on a device, like a browser, a user's device. Public key is stored by your server as the developer. And then that data that gets used to authenticate and log users in have to work with those two keys in comparison. So if you look at this little emoji image here, a user comes to a site, so I want to create a new account, I want to register. The browser will say, okay, create a public key for me, which we'll do as developers on the UI. We create a new key pair in the browser, and the browser stores the private, we store the public, and then that's used to log users in and to create accounts. And what's nice about this is it sounds super complicated, right? Biometrics, what the heck is that? And irises and fingerprints, but it's really not that difficult. It's built into the browser. So I'm sure we all grew up, at least people that have been around, to relying on web APIs for a lot of different things. Now we just use Vue and React and Angular and everything else to kind of do everything for us. But a lot of stuff is just built right into the browsers like this. So you can see that we have navigator.credentials.create. This is in the browser. We can create a public key, create the private key companionship there, and it's all done for us. All the heavy lifting of the biometrics and the signature stuff, most of that is done by platform. On our side as developers, we just have to store a couple things and give it a couple things, and then that's how we keep the user's information secure and not ask for them for a password. And you might be asking, what's the support on this? You can go through each one of these little purple squares and look more into it. Gist of it is Chrome is kind of across the board. The Chromium type stuff is also good. Firefox has a couple holes here and there. But the support is pretty good across the board for platforms. All right, so we got a couple more minutes. Let's actually look through some code of how we can do this on our side. Now, I'm just going to show you the front end side of things, the Vue side of things. You still need a server side and a database to kind of store some stuff. So we'll kind of wave our hands on a couple of these lines. But this is the Vue side. So we've got our two buttons. We've got a register button, a login button with functions of register and login. This first part here, let's talk about the register function. There's a challenge that we need to create on our backend, basically just going to be a bunch of random bits of information that we use to make sure that the session doesn't get repeated, and we get that from our own endpoint, our own backend. Then we go to the browser again, or the platform, and ask us to start creating a public and private key companionship, or create that handshake. And in order for the browser to create it, we just got to give it a couple of configurations. A lot of this stuff is not too complicated. We have to tell it who we are. So the RP is the relying party. That's us. Give it a name. We pass through some user information, a name, identifier of some kind. You can see I'm creating like this unit 8 array of 16 in a display name. And then we describe what type of public key you want to create. There's a whole list, and anybody that actually cares, there's a whole bunch of different types that you can, but we give it a couple little objects, configurations inside of here, and the response that we get back from this create is our public key, which we did at the bottom there, post to a route that we own. So then on our database, we're storing a user-specific public key, and it's public meaning that it's okay if your database gets hacked. So if your database gets hacked, obviously that's not good. But if it does get hacked, then it's useless. The public and private key combinations are useless to unless you know the private, which is stored on the device, like a browser and your computers and phones. So on our side of things, we just store the public key created by the browser like Chrome. Now, when a user comes back and they want to log in, this is where on an application like eBay, I think, does it as well, where you give it your email and the browser creates a assertion of some kind, and that's where it asks for your fingerprint. And that fingerprint of yours is intertwined with a private key that was initially stored when you create an account. And again, this all sounds super complicated, but it's done mostly by the platform. It's mostly by Chrome. All that you need to worry about on your side is storing that public key. And the code here, as you can see, is not too crazy. We have to create a login function. The assertion is created by the browser. And we pass through some credentials that we have stored about the user, like their ID and that it's a public key. And once the browser verifies that your assertion has worked, whether you did iris or you did your fingerprint, it responds back with another kind of object, and it's signed with the private key that it's stored, and it gets sent to us, where we validate that signature to us with the public key which we stored. And don't worry, there's SDKs and NPM packages and stuff out there that you can use to do that. But all you do is you pull out the public key that you stored and you validate the private key of that user, and then you send back your access tokens and ID tokens and whatnot. So this is only probably 60% of the code that you need, but this is most of the front end code that you need. on your side to set up that login. So in the end, what makes a web authent unique is that you don't have to store passwords in your database. A lot of people do store passwords still today, especially if you roll your own authentication. You're not using someone like Auth0 or some kind of identity provider. If you store that stuff, imagine getting rid of passwords. If your users are on supported platforms and just relying on that public key to authenticate and sign users in. And most of the work is done for you. You don't have to do all that heavy lifting and storing of passwords and stuff yourself. That's it for me. If you want to look at some of this, there's a couple other links here that I put. A lot of this stuff is built into Auth0's SDK. You can also find me on Twitter. I can send you the slides. It's just I am Tyler W. Clark. But that's it. Thanks.